الحمد لله الحمد لله الصانع الخلق على أكمل نظام وأحسن قوام، الواضع الأشياء في أجدر مقام وأرفق مصام، والصلاة والسلام على المؤيد بأبلغ كلام لهداية كافة الأنام كبدر تجلى من بين الغمام، وعلى آله وأصحابه الكرام إلى مدى الليالي والأيام. فالحمد لله الذي نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونؤمن به ونتوكل عليه ونعوذ به من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، ونشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، ونشهد أن محمدًا عبد الله ورسوله أرسله الله تعالى بالهدى ودين الحق ليظهره على الدين كله وكفى بالله شهيدا، فصلى الله عليه وسلم تسليما كثيرا كثيرا. ثم أما بعد، فإن أصدق الحديث كتاب الله، وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم، وإن شر الأمور محدثاتها، وإن كل محدثة بدعة، وكل بدعة ضلالة، وكل ضلالة في النار. يقول سبحانه وتعالى في كتابه الكريم بعد أن أقول أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم: إن الله يأمركم أن تؤدوا الأمانات إلى أهلها، وإذا حكمتم بين الناس أن تحكموا بالعدل، إن الله نعم ما يعظكم به، إن الله كان سميعا بصيرا. يا أيها الذين آمنوا أطيعوا الله وأطيعوا الرسول وأولي الأمر منكم، فإن تنازعتم في شيء فردوه إلى الله والرسول إن كنتم تؤمنون بالله واليوم الآخر ذلك خير وأحسن تأويلا. رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي، واللهم ثبتنا عند الموت بلا إله إلا الله، واللهم اجعلنا من الذين آمنوا وعملوا الصالحات وتواصوا بالحق وتواصوا بالصبر، آمين يا رب العالمين. Today's khutbah, my attempt is to share some lessons from two ayat that go adjacent to each other in Surah An-Nisa. These are ayat number 58 and 59. There's a lot to talk about in these ayat, but I'm trying to just select some of these important lessons that I need a reminder of, and I think everyone here does too. The first thing I'd like to share with you is a simple distinction, a separation between two concepts. And those two concepts are the difference between law and justice. That sounds simple enough, but a lot of times when we talk about the justice system, for example in modern language, a lot of people think of the legal system, right? And even a judge in court is called a justice, right? A Supreme Court justice. And so in using these terms, law and justice, interchangeably, we start thinking they're one and the same thing, but they're actually not. They're two very, very different things. You can have the best laws. You can have the best laws, but you could still have injustice. They don't go together. You can have the perfect laws. Even the best of all laws is the law of Allah, the law that He revealed. And there's nothing fairer and more just than the law of Allah. But even when you implement the law of Allah, it is possible to take advantage of the law of Allah. That can happen. For instance, there are cases in which a crime is committed in our religion where if you have witnesses, then the punishment must be executed if you have witnesses. But those witnesses, and if the community sees that those witnesses are reliable and they're truthful and they're honest, then those witnesses are acceptable and the law is implemented and somebody gets punished. But it's very possible that those witnesses lie. It's possible. And even in the name of Islam, even though Sharia was implemented, the law was implemented, justice was not served. There is a difference between these two things. Now the Quran is very wise in the way it depicts this difference. And really at the heart of my khutbah today, these two ayat are one of the most beautiful places in the Quran where Allah makes the distinction between these two very different things. As a matter of fact, when Muslims have an argument with each other, a lot of times we say, well, what does Allah have to say about this? What does Allah say? Let's follow the dalil and follow the sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ or the ayah of the Quran, and we'll do whatever Quran says. We will follow the law of Allah. We will follow the Sharia of Islam. And we assume that by following the law of Allah or the Sharia of Islam, that we are going to arrive at justice. But actually, Allah Azza wa Jal places a prerequisite before the law. He puts another condition before the law. And if you don't follow that condition, you may end up using the law, but you'll end up misusing the law. Even though it will look to everyone as though you implemented the book of Allah or implemented the sunnah of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam. To make you think about this another way, think of a plant. You know, the outside of a plant is something else and the roots are something else. And Allah Azza wa Jal is going to describe justice as the roots. And then the plant itself that comes out of it, that you benefit from, whose fruit you eat from, is the laws and the conditions and the requirements of this religion. So let's begin, inshallah, in this incredible, incredible ayah. Allah says, إِنَّ اللَّهَ يَأْمُرُكُمْ أَن تُؤَدُّ الْأَمَانَاتِ إِلَىٰ أَهْلِهَا. In fact, Allah is the one, He's in fact commanded you that you fulfill the rights, أَن تُؤَدُّ الْأَمَانَاتِ, that you execute and you fulfill all rights. And amanat are also trusts. Amanat are all, aman comes from the word aman actually, which means to be peace or to be secure. You know, to be at peace or to be secure. Things that you feel someone else should secure for you. Things that someone should help safeguard. That you fulfill those trusts and you give them to the people who deserve them. And before I go on with this ayah, I will give you a little bit of an introduction. This ayah is actually not about law, it's about justice. It's about justice. And in this ayah, Allah Azza wa Jalla has opened the door, and He didn't even say "Addul amanat ila ahliha," fulfill the trusts, execute the trusts. He began "Inna Allaha ya'murukum." No doubt, it is in fact Allah. He is telling you. And why would He do that? Suratul Nisa, which this ayah belongs to, has so many ahkam, so many things Allah has told us to do. Allah has given us advice about inheritance in these ayat. Allah has given us, injunctions on what to do on the battlefield. All kinds of ayat are there in this surah where Allah is giving us commands. But the surah doesn't begin by Allah just saying the command itself. He says, إِنَّ اللَّهَ يَأْمُرُكُمْ. He, يعني أضاف في الكلام. No doubt it is in fact Allah. He's the one telling you. This is mentioned particularly because of course if a Muslim hears a command from Allah, he knows it's from Allah. There's no argument left. But Allah highlights every word in the Quran is for a particular purpose. And one of the benefits of just beginning with إِنَّ اللَّهَ يَأْمُرُكُمْ is that the ahkam, the rules, or the advice that's being given in this ayah happens to be the kind of advice that you and I tend to forget. And we don't remember that it's actually from Allah. You know, when it comes to salah, everybody remembers that that's from Allah. You don't think twice about whether that's from Allah or not. When it comes to someone preparing for Hajj, they don't wonder who are they obeying. They're obeying Allah. When somebody's about to fast, they don't think about who they're obeying. They're obeying Allah. But when it comes to giving people what they owe, what you owe them, fulfilling a trust, and we're going to dive deeper into fulfilling this trust. What does that mean? It's not just that, for example, somebody entrusted you back in the day, somebody gave you some money, and they said, I'm traveling. Can you hold on to this money for me? Because we didn't have banks back in the day. You didn't secure something deposit something somewhere in a safety deposit box. You trusted somebody and they held your money for you. They held your animals for you. They held your clothes or maybe even they guarded your house for you. And then you come back after 6 months and they're going to give it back to you. They're not going to act like they don't know what they're talking about, you know. And you hold on to the money yourself or I don't even know you. This is my house. You don't do that. You give people back what you owe them. That's a simple explanation of this ayah. But the words are so open and so beautiful. In that actually, in pretty much every relationship you and I have, whether it's a spousal relationship or the relationship I have with my children or my parents or my coworkers or my friends, fellow Muslims, my relationship with even government, all these relationships, there's something that people have trusted me with and I have trusted them with. I trusted them with something. Your close friend, you trusted him with a secret. He said, listen, I'm telling you this, I needed to talk to someone, so I'm talking to you, don't tell anyone else. This is between us. And he goes and says, by the way man, I was just talking to him, it's just between us, I need to tell you, and he spreads it around. You gave him a trust, and you have to hold that trust. So you give the trust to people who deserve them. You give them back. Similarly, in the relationship between husband and wife, in parent and child, in all of these relationships, there's an expectation. I have an expectation. Some things I've trusted her with, some things she's trusted me with. And we have to maintain and uphold that trust. There are certain rights I have, certain needs I have, there are certain needs that she has. And I have to go out of my way to fulfill those needs. This is actually, in this ayah, what's incredible is that Allah Azza wa Jalla is resorting back to the fitrah. Instead of talking about the technicalities, instead of making a long list, by the way, this is what you owe to A, this is what you owe to B, this is what you owe to C. There's a fitrah. Human beings know what they owe their parents. Human beings know what they owe their sibling, what they owe to their neighbor, what they owe to their spouse. To some level, every human being has some concept of justice. That's the first condition in our existence. We're not just following the law of Allah. The first thing Allah gave us is a compass inside of ourselves. We have the ability to make sense of what is right and what is wrong. What someone deserves, what someone doesn't deserve. Even if you take this ayah further, as some ulama have, they'll talk about even when you hire someone. You know, there's a job opening. And you have your responsibility. You're not the owner of the business. You're in charge of human resources. You're the one who does the interviews. You're going to hire your cousin or you're going to hire the best qualified. You know, you give the job to the one who's best qualified, not the one who has the best connections. Not the one that you feel, okay, you know what, I have to help my Muslim brother out. What if there's a non-Muslim who's better qualified than the Muslim? And he deserves that job more than the Muslim does. Then you don't say, my Muslim brother, I'm going to help my Muslim brother. You go with justice. You fulfill the rights where they are, where they belong. Similarly, even in government, at the much larger scale, even in government, who do you put into office? Who do you vote for? Who do you, you know, consider that they should have the responsibility of governorship or even taking care of a village, for example? A lot of politics, you all know, is full of corruption. People don't bring into power people they feel are the most worthy, but rather what connections and what lobbies and what other side games are played before you put someone in office. And in this one ayah, from the family structure, from the very beginning, all the way to the top, one principle, that you don't give someone a trust unless they deserve it, unless they're qualified for it. You give them what they're qualified for. And that's, it's such a powerful thing, subhanAllah. But I want to, instead of talking about large scale or government, before I move on, just a very quick small example. Somebody comes to you and asks your opinion about your friend because they're considering their family for marriage and they want to know your opinion. Now he's your friend. And you know good things about him and you know bad things about him. Now two things happen. Sometimes you really love your friend and even though you know he has a drinking problem and he's got some other serious issues, you say, man, I got to cover for my friend. And he really likes this girl. So I'm going to make sure that I tell them that, yeah, he's great. He's amazing. He's at the masjid every day. And he's, you know. So you hooked your friend up, but you destroyed somebody else's life. This is actually a violation of amana. On the other hand, sometimes you have a grudge against someone. Somebody asked you the opinion, should I hire this person? I'm considering this person for a job in my company. I think you know them. They worked for you before. Should I hire them? And you don't like them. Personally, you don't like them. It has nothing to do with their job or whether or not they fulfilled their obligations at work. You personally don't like them. You don't like the way they look, or you don't like the way they talk, or you don't like that they didn't listen to you this one time. You have this grudge against them. So you give them a bad review, or you refuse to acknowledge them, or you actually throw them under the bus so they can't get a job with anybody else. You do that. This is a violation of أَن تُؤَدُّ الْأَمَانَاتِ إِلَىٰ أَهْلِهَا. You cannot quote ayat and references and bring out books of rules and regulations and apply this. You have to, this is right at the spur of the moment, whether you're going to do the right thing or not. This is why Allah begins, إِنَّ اللَّهَ يَأْمُرُكُمْ أَن تُؤَدُّ الْأَمَانَاتِ إِلَىٰ أَهْلِهَا. When time comes to give people what they deserve, give them the opinion they deserve, give them the truth that they deserve, give them the rights that they deserve. At that moment, nobody's going to open up a tafsir and say, let me check what you deserve. Nobody's going to do that. What's going to come in your head are a bunch of biases. If I give him this, what do I lose? What do I have to gain? And what we don't think about is what is right and what is wrong. That's the first criteria of justice that every human being has to live with inside of themselves. This is our conscience that's being woken up. Then he says, وَإِذَا حَكَمْتُمْ بَيْنَ النَّاسِ أَن تَحْكُمُوا بِالْعَدْلِ. Such incredible words. And when the time comes that you are going to make judgments between people, that you make sure that you pass judgment with justice. Now look at the transition. In the first part of this ayah, أَن تُؤَدُّ الْأَمَانَاتِ إِلَىٰ أَهْلِهَا, you have to be a person of character. You have to give people what they deserve. You have to fulfill the trust. This is about you personally. You have to check yourself. I have to check myself. Now that you're working on doing that, then Allah says, sometimes you have to make judgments between other people. Now this is not about you. This is now about other people. Two people have a dispute. They're having an argument and they asked you your opinion. And Allah did not say, إِنْ حَكَمْتُمْ بَيْنَ النَّاسِ قَالْ إِذَا حَكَمْتُمْ بَيْنَ النَّاسِ فَالْفَرْقُ وَاضِحِ. He doesn't say, if you have to make judgment. He says, when you'll make judgment. When? Because every single human being at one point or another will be involved in some kind of, you know, negotiation between people, and their opinion is going to matter. They're going to be made a judge. Allah is not asking, well, in case you're a judge of a court, then this ayah applies to you. No. There's an argument happening between two siblings and you're the third one and you have to give your opinion. Or you have to give good, sincere counsel. There's an argument happening inside family. And you have to give your, you know, your honest verdict about who's right and who's wrong to the best of your ability. وَإِذَا حَكَمْتُمْ بَيْنَ النَّاسِ. When you're going to pass judgments between people, that you do so justly. So that if you don't meet the first condition, If you and I are not able to give people what they deserve, there's no way we're going to pass judgments fairly. The second one's never going to happen. وَإِذَا حَكَمْتُمْ بَيْنَ النَّاسِ أَن تَحْكُمُوا بِالْعَدْلِ. What I'm also really like stunned by is Allah could have just said, إِنَّ اللَّهَ يَأْمُرُكُمْ أَن تُؤَدُّوا الْأَمَانَاتِ إِلَىٰ أَهْلِهَا وَأَن تَحْكُمُوا بِالْعَدْلِ. Simple. خَيْرُ الْكَلَامِ مَا قَلَّ وَدَلَّ. The easiest thing to do is just say, give people what they deserve, give them their rights, their trusts, and on top of that, judge fairly. That's it. But he says, إِذَا حَكَمْتُمْ بَيْنَ النَّاسِ أَن تَحْكُمُوا بِالْعَدْلِ. تَكْرَارُ اللَّفْظِ. First of all, hukum twice. And whenever you make judgments, you know what that means? That actually means just because you made a fair judgment yesterday does not mean today when you're asked again that you'll make a fair judgment again. You have to come fresh to it and never assume that you're going to be fair. You have to refresh and rethink all of the criteria before you pass judgment. Every case is new. Every case is new. Even if two people had a dispute, your two brothers had a dispute yesterday, and they came back with another dispute today, you cannot use yesterday's example and say, you know what, I already know who's wrong. You can't do that. There's a new case today, even if it's the same two people. You have to come back to it over and over and over again, and every single time, if and when it happens, you and I have to stick by what is fair. Now the remarkable thing, Allah didn't say, أَن تَحْكُمُوا بِالْقِسْطِ. He said, أَن تَحْكُمُوا بِالْعَدْلِ. There's a difference, there's two different words for justice in the Arabic language. Qist is actually justice that's done in private even. But al-adl is clearly illustrated in many examples of literature, justice that's done openly. Justice that's done in public, where the evidences are clear. You know, sometimes there's a secret trial, nobody knows what happened inside the courtroom, and then you just know this one's guilty. That's all you know, and everybody questions, hey, how do you know he's guilty? We didn't see any evidence. It was never made public. No. This is a matter of national security. We can't show you the evidence. We keep it secret. But when you use the word adil, what you're saying is, not only will you pass a judgment, you will give clear evidence reasons. Why are you passing this judgment? You're not just being asked for your opinion. You're asked to elaborate, why did you arrive at this opinion? It's not enough that you're the senior in the family or the elder in the family. Bas keh diya to keh diya. I said it, that's it. What do you mean? You're questioning my judgment? No, أن تحكموا بالعدل. You must give your reasons. You must provide justification. This is what you have to do. It's not just that you just judge fairly. If it was only about fairness, قسط would have sufficed. But the fact that the word عدل is used, you have to demonstrate the evidence. Everybody involved in the dispute has to know why you arrived at the conclusion you arrived at. Now, at this point, what Allah has done, basically, He hasn't mentioned any laws or any regulations. He's just taught us how to deal with each other. That's all He's taught. How do you deal with each other? And these principles are far beyond even the Muslims. That's why this ayah, unlike so many ayat of Surah An-Nisa, where there are ahkam, Allah gives rulings to Muslims, it doesn't begin with, Ya أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا. Actually, the next ayah is going to begin, Ya أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا. This one doesn't. إِنَّ اللَّهَ يَأْمُرُكُمْ أَن تُؤَدُّوا الْأَمَانَاتِ إِلَىٰ أَهْلِهَا. وَإِذَا حَكَمْتُمْ بَيْنَ النَّاسِ أَن تَحْكُمُوا بِالْعَدْلِ. Doesn't even say, and إِذَا حَكَمْتُمْ بَيْنَكُمْ بَيْنَ النَّاسِ, among people, all people. Because every human being is capable of understanding what is fair and what is not fair. That compass is inside of us. Then he says about this advice, which seems like very simple advice. Allah does not consider this a small bit of advice. Allah, of all the different rulings and verdicts and counsel that He gives in the Quran, look, it's sometimes He just goes out of His way to say, maybe you didn't realize the weight of these words. So the ayah is still not done. He says, إِنَّ اللَّهَ نِعِمَّا يَعِذُكُمْ بِهِ. It is no doubt, in fact, Allah, what an incredible bit of advice that He's giving you. How awesome, نِعِمَّا يَعِذُكُمْ بِهِ. Is going out of His way to say, I just gave you this advice, and you need to realize how serious, how powerful this advice is. And look at the switch. It began with, He commands you, إِنَّ اللَّهَ يَأْمُرُكُمْ, and now يَعِذُكُمْ. إِنَّ اللَّهَ نِعِمَّا يَعِذُكُمْ بِهِ. This is another important consideration. I know my time's running out, but we have to talk about this. This is really important, guys. When we think about Allah's instructions, when we think about what Allah told us to do, most Muslims, the only thing they think about is halal and haram. Allah said, this is halal, this is haram. Do this and don't do this. This is what Allah wants. It's just a bunch of rules and regulations of what you must do and what you must not do. What you must eat and what you must not eat, etc., etc. Right? So we've reduced all of it to basically halal and haram and what is absolutely wajib or fard on you, etc. And that's it. And so especially for a younger generation, you know what's happened? Oh man, is that haram too? Is this haram too? Everything's haram, you know?
anything fun is haram and anything boring is fard. That's pretty much the picture in their head. And now what's happened as a result in that mindset of the Muslim, that all Islam is a bunch of rules about what you must and must not do. Now people, young people even, and even elders, whenever you give them advice, they say, is that fard? Do I have to do that? Or you give them advice not to do something, is it haram? Should I not do it because it's haram? Hey bro, I don't think you should hang out late at night. What, is it haram? Is there an ayah about that? No, I know that you're just joking around, but I think you should kind of lower your volume. Is that haram to raise my voice? And so every time you try to give someone advice, their first line of defense is, where's your fatwa? Where's the verdict that what I'm doing is haram? Because unless it's haram, it shouldn't be a problem. You understand? But you know, this is like a really bad way of thinking about our religion. A really poor way of thinking about our religion. And in this ayah, there's the answer to that. But I'll give you a silly example first. Because a young girl came to me one time, whose mother was giving her advice about not, you know, staying up all night, you know, late at night and watching movies and things like that. And she asked me, is it haram? And I'm not going to give her a fatwa about movies. So I asked her, listen, are you allergic to any foods? And she said, yeah, I'm allergic to peanuts. So I said, let me get you a bag of peanuts. No, no, I don't want to eat peanuts. Why not? It's bad for me. It's bad for me. Is it haram? Are peanuts haram? No, I don't think peanuts are haram. I don't think they come from pigs or anything. But they're a really bad idea for you, aren't they? It's bad advice to give you peanuts, isn't it? There's a difference between something being part of the law and something being part of advice. Advice. Allah's laws, all of them, are actually not just laws. They are advice that's good for you. They're good for you. Sometimes there's a law and all it is a nuisance. It's just a burden. But Allah began with إِنَّ اللَّهَ يَأْمُرُكُمْ and then by the end describes that actually as much as this is a command, more than a command, it's an incredible bit of advice. It'll save you so much trouble in life. So many of your problems will start getting resolved if you just decide that you will give people what they deserve. That when you pass a verdict, that you're going to think about being fair every single time. You won't make assumptions. You won't rush to judgment. If you can just follow that, so good this advice will be for you in this life and in the next. إِنَّ اللَّهَ نِعِمَّا يَعِذُكُمْ بِهِ And then he ends this ayah by saying, إِنَّ اللَّهَ كَانَ سَمِيعًا بَصِيرًا No doubt Allah has always heard. Allah has always been the one who listens and always been the one who sees. It's so amazing that these two names of Allah are used. The one who hears and the one who sees and the one who's always heard and the one who's always seen. Why is that significant? Because when you give someone their rights, or you don't give someone their rights, you always have a justification. Well, you don't know what happened before, bro. You don't have the full story. I know the full story. When you pass a judgment, you look at prior evidence. You look at what came before. And then you use that, and nobody else knows it like you do. You can just say, well, you don't know, I know, and based on what I know, I'm telling you, this is my verdict. Or this is what I'm going to give, or this is what I'm not going to give. This is what this one deserves, and this is what they don't deserve. And Allah answers by saying, you have prior knowledge, but nobody knows more than I do. Allah Azza wa Jalla is telling you, he heard all of it. All of the things that you experienced before you led to the point where you gave someone their right or didn't give them their right. All the experiences, all the things you heard and observed and saw before you passed judgment, Allah is the one who saw all of what you saw. He knows what you evaluated, what you omitted, what you kept, what you prioritized, what you conveniently overlooked. He knows all of it. إِنَّ اللَّهَ كَانَ سَمِيعًا بَصِيرًا In this ayah, if you remember nothing else from this khutbah, in this one ayah, Allah is just telling you and I to watch out for becoming unfair. We have to be fair people. And now that you are conscious of becoming fair, now you appreciate the next ayah. يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا أَطِيعُوا اللَّهَ وَأَطِيعُوا الرَّسُولَ وَأُولِي الْأَمْرِ مِنْكُمْ Those of you who have iman, obey Allah and obey the Messenger, and those who have command among you. Those who are able to make decisions among you. The ones who have the right to make decision among you. Why is the obey Allah and obey the Messenger here now? This is about the law of Allah. The revealed law of Allah. This is haram and this is halal and this is what you must do and this is what you must not do. This is now second. Why? Because if you yourself are not fair, then the law of Allah won't do any benefit to you. You have to transform yourself first. Become a person of amana, of ta'diyatul amana. You and I have to become a people of hukum bil adl first. Then the law of Allah will actually be of benefit to you and me. then we'll actually, enjoy the fruits of it. How many times have we seen the law of Allah, the ayat of Quran, the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ misused for the most unjust purposes, in the most absurd ways? You know, and this even happens today in Muslim countries, in Supreme Court, rulings. Ayat of Quran being used to do injustice. Why? Because the criteria isn't there. أطيعوا الله وأطيعوا الرسول وأولي الأمر منكم. Notice the third one, أولي الأمر. There's no أطيعوا there because it's not absolute. But there's another reason, very beautiful. You know, in the previous ayah, Allah said, make sure you give trust to those who deserve them. And if you did that, you'd be in a good position in your family. You'd be in a good position in your business. You'd be in a good position in your community. But overall, you would put good people in position of authority. When people individually become people of justice, then they start putting in the right kind of people take the right kinds of positions in that society. And so you will get to a point where people actually deserve amr among you. They're in the right places. It starts not just transforming your individual self, it gets to the point where it can transform an entire society. What I want to conclude with is a reality check. It is from Allah. It's such a practical religion, subhanAllah. فَإِن تَنَازَعْتُمْ فِي شَيْءٍ فَرُدُّهُ إِلَى اللَّهِ وَالرَّسُولِ. SubhanAllah. If you are going to get some kind of disagreement when you're pulling and tugging among each other, then make sure you refer back to Allah and the Messenger. Now Allah is talking about people that want to be fair, because that's already covered. People that are going to try to make justice happen to the best of their ability, that's already covered. And even then they have a disagreement. It is not that when two people have a disagreement, one of them is evil and one of them is good. It is not that simple. Sometimes two people have a disagreement and they have a serious disagreement and they're pulling at each other, and yet both of them are trying to be as fair as they possibly can be. That happens. There's not necessarily one wrong and one right. It doesn't work that way. And when that situation happens, and it will happen because we're human beings, nobody's perfect. Everybody acts to the best of their ability, to the best of their intentions. When that happens, then you take the matter back to Allah and the Messenger, you let the revelation decide. Because they try to do justice to the best of their ability, at the end of the day, we're going to have to go with what Allah says, what the Messenger says, sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And we're going to submit our own opinions before Allah and the Messenger. So if Allah and the Messenger say, it's okay, it doesn't matter if you don't like it, it's okay. If Allah says, let it go, it doesn't matter if you want to hold on to it, you let it go. If Allah says punish and you don't want to punish, Allah says punish, you must punish. We're gonna have to submit ourselves to the verdict that is passed by Allah and the Messenger, sallallahu alaihi wasallam. You know why that's mentioned, by the way? Because when you are fighting for justice, and your brother is fighting you, your spouse is fighting, your family is fighting you, and they're also fighting for justice, they're thinking they're just too, then if you win, they're going to think injustice happened. And if you win, they're going to think what? Injustice happened. And the only way this can be resolved is you have to take it back to Allah and the Messenger and submit your own opinion of justice, let it go, and let Allah be the judge. And that can only happen if you believe in the final judgment of Allah, where your intentions will actually count. إِن كُنْتُمْ تُؤْمِنُونَ بِاللَّهِ وَالْيَوْمِ الْآخِرِ. If in fact you truly believe in Allah and the last days in this ayah. This ayah is not about akhirah. Why is this here? Because sometimes a verdict is passed. You had the best of intentions, but the verdict was passed against you. It wasn't the way you expected it to go, but Allah still knows the justice with which, the intention of justice you had, the fairness that you were working with. And Allah will count that for you on Judgment Day. So you, even if you got debited in this world, you will be credited in the next, even if the verdict went against you. SubhanAllah. So you have to believe in Allah and the last day. ذَلِكَ خَيْرٌ. That's better. Allah is telling you that's better. Literally telling the guy who lost the verdict is better. وَأَحْسَنُ تَأْوِيلًا. And it's more beautiful, and it's long-term implications, تَأْوِيلًا. It'll play out for you in your favor. You'll be saving your own iman. May Allah Azza wa Jal make us a people of justice, and a people that are able to not manipulate the law of Allah, but first ask their own conscience whether they're doing the right thing or not. I tell you, the law of Allah deals with the most serious issues. But most of the day, most of your 24 hours is going to be decisions you and I will have to make, that you will not resort to Allah and the Messenger's, the Book of Allah and the Sunnah of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Most of the time, you're going to have to ask your own conscience. Most of the time, you're just going to be a quick second thing. And these reminders from Allah and the Messenger, they invoke and they empower in us our sense of justice, our sense of fairness, and our sense of giving people what they actually deserve. So may Allah Azza wa Jal not make us of those who wrong others and don't wrong themselves by not giving the amanat where they belong. And may Allah Azza wa Jal give us among ourselves, in our families, in our communities, in the ummah at large, people who are truly people of amr that can make fair decisions to the best of their ability. And may Allah Azza wa Jal, especially when we have disagreements among each other, make our hearts content with the final verdict of Allah and the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Barakallahu li wa lakum fil Qur'an al-Hakim wa nafa'ani وإياكم بالآيات والذكر الحكيم. الحمد لله وكفى والصلاة والسلام على عباده الذين اصطفى خصوصا على أفضلهم وخاتم النبيين محمد الأمين وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. يقول الله عز وجل في كتابه الكريم بعد أن أقول أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم: إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما. اللهم صل على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما صليت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم في العالمين إنك حميد مجيد. اللهم بارك على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما باركت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم في العالمين إنك حميد مجيد. عباد الله رحمكم الله، اتقوا الله، إن الله يأمر بالعدل والإحسان وإيتاء ذي القربى وينهى عن الفحشاء والمنكر ولذكر الله أكبر والله يعلم ما تصنعون. أقم الصلاة إن الصلاة كانت على المؤمنين كتابا موقوتا.